Hello. Okay. Sorry about that. So some of you started in this area and have been working in data for quite some time. Some of you haven't. What kind of advice would you give to someone who is, you know, mid-career, deciding that this is really interesting stuff and are looking to do a change from what they have done for perhaps the last, 20 years or so? So how do you navigate that? And then how do your colleagues react when they're like, wait a minute, we hired you to do this thing, and now you're doing this other thing, and we don't know what this is? So
my first piece of advice is, if you are an academic, you've always been working with data. So the first thing to do is embrace the nature of the data that you have and understand what contributions it has to offer, and to make sure that other people don't pigeonhole what you're doing as not what you're supposed to be doing or not legitimate for your science. So, to figure out how what your new approach brings to the work that wasn't there before, and what the benefits for your field and for your research are to be found by changing what looks like changing gears. I mean, that sounds very milquetoasty, but I think the problem starts with when you want to start working with data. You've always been working with data, always, all of you, I'm sure.
I think another effective thing to think about is what skills your research brings to a collaborator, and then to exploit those skills when you start reaching out. So there are certain things that, you know, the skills you'll have as an engineer or as individuals who work with data in different ways, and really thinking about what benefit that might provide to somebody else, what benefit you could really bring to the discussion, I think makes it a lot easier to figure out what next steps there might be.
I'll add, Joanna. One is, I think it would be very important that you have a compelling reason for what you want to get out of the data, and you may not necessarily ultimately achieve that role, but that goal. I think it's for me, for instance, personally, getting into the area, there was something not necessarily definitive, but there's something I thought I could do that needs to be done, and nobody else was doing. So that can allow you to chart out, you know, a slightly different niche area. The other thing, back to how, you know, my colleagues viewed me, there wasn't too much concern for me there, but it's completely true when it comes to publishing. Because I was new to the domain, I'm still new to the area. I can assure you, most computer science don't consider this cybersecurity, and most data science will not consider this data science. Well, a bit, maybe. So I think it is probably to be expected that there may be that there will be difficulty. It will take some time to navigate that. Still, that's why I come back to. If you have a compelling reason for doing that, then that can help, I think, both the researcher and the students to basically persevere till they succeed.
Sell it, girl, sell it.
Yes. Question.
Hi, I'm a graduate student in the School of Information and the School of Natural Resources. I am curious, I was fascinated by the variety of projects and applications that was presented today. And while I assume that a number of the tools and skill sets that are required are domain specific and, you know, very specialized, I was curious as to what ones you would say are critical skills that everyone coming into this should know.
All right, so I'm the mathematician here, and you know, what skill sets? What are core fundamental skill sets? Yes, I am the mathematician, but first and foremost, an open mind. An open mind, curiosity, fearlessness, and I'm going to end with fearlessness on my list of personal qualities, because now I'm going to get to mathematics. So, you know, on a technical fundamental level, what sort of skills? You know, I'm going to argue sort of rudimentary linear algebra, some comfort and ability to do computer programming, and that sort of ties in with the fearlessness. Let's see, some computer programming, linear algebra, and sort of an ability to reason abstractly about problems and data. And that, I mean, that is math. Anybody else want?
Being a junior faculty in the sport, and so I wasn't, I was a, not too long ago, I was a grad student, so I think I can add to the maybe the student point of view. I feel statistics on top of the list is quite important. So, and also just add up to the question earlier, so regarding to how to work with data, I think myself actually being trained more from the theoretical side dealing with models, and incorporating data or data-driven approach is also fairly new. After I become a faculty member, I become more dealing with data myself. And I do find it pretty challenging because as many of the panelists here already mentioned, it's quite a lot of work to just clean the data up and to understand the domain knowledge. So it takes quite some effort, and I do find collaboration with a domain expert, with a colleague, and who can teach me the meaning of the data, how to deal with it, and then and after they translate this whole thing into my comfort zone, into I once I can think of this using the model, then it becomes a lot easier to, yeah, so I do find the help from a colleague and collaboration very helpful, so yeah. Thanks.
So I'm just going to say that I don't think they're, other than general properties as a scholar and a thinker, I don't think there is one Uber methodology or one, I mean, I think what you have to do is be willing to collaborate with people who have the skills that you don't have, and to be, to figure out, you know, where your lane is, right? And how then you're a resource to others just as they are a resource to you. So I hesitate to say everybody should at least sort of basically know how to program, because right now, computer science and programming, and you're weeding women out left and right there. So don't walk out of here saying, if I don't want to take any programming courses and I don't program, I can't be a data scientist, because that's not the message I want to get here. What you need to do is bring something to the table to collaborate with computer scientists and mathematicians and people who are maybe doing the part of the data that you don't want to do and you aren't trained to do.
I'd also say carefulness. When you're working with real data, data are extremely complex, and there are a lot of unexpected correlations that happen. Some of those are interesting, some of those are in error. And so being really careful with error analysis and being really methodical in how you go about building large-scale systems to process data is critical.
I'll just echo two things. One is critical thinking, with or without the data. The other is patience, a lot of patience.
Do you have a question over here?
Hi, good morning. I just want to give you some feedback. I mean, I thought I'm industry, and I thought I'd come in here and talk algorithms, and that put me off a little bit for coming, but I want to say thank you, because I'm hearing a lot of questions of how do I get this started, how do I get this going, so I feel like I'm in the right place at the right time, and that's terrific, and thank you. My question is, and we heard a lot about collaborators, I know, I don't know how many industry people are in the room, but I'd like to ask, how did you find your collaborators? I'm having a really tough time with that.
So I used to work in industry. Yeah. I worked in an industrial research lab. And so part of finding the collaborators, you know, we listened to people who had sort of pressing business problems. So you know, when people started complaining, you know, this doesn't work, I don't know how to do that, those people, talk to them, yeah. Or more importantly, listen to them. You know, I would also say have an open mind. And when people say, I don't know how to do this, or I can't solve that, or this is a big challenge for me, ask them more. Those are the people that you want to work with.
Okay.
I'll say also, I know people say this all the time, but in my case, it's very, very true. It's networking. So I met colleagues through the Depression Center about a month after I got to Michigan. We were having we have every year a faculty recognition dinner, and one of the emeritus faculty in my department said, "Oh, you're doing work in emotion. You should definitely talk to folks at the Depression Center," which at the time I didn't actually know was a thing. And so through that meeting, it ended up in what's now been a 4.5-year collaboration. The project with aphasia started because, this is incredible, one of the more senior faculty in my department, his trainer at the time was the director of the UMAP, and they were really interested in trying to figure out how to collaborate with computer scientists. And so I went there not really knowing what aphasia was, and they met up with me not really knowing what I did. And so it was through an initial lunch that led to what is now a 4.5-year collaboration. The project with suicidality got started because we had a lot of press after an app was released for our project with bipolar disorder, and someone from Brown contacted us to say, "Oh, are you interested in trying this domain?" And we said, "Well, that sounds fascinating. There are a lot of problems that are both similar and different from what we've tried so far." And so I think entirely it's been through networking in my case, which has been quite nice.
And then I'll add, some of it is chutzpah. So in the case of the dashboard with the student dashboard, I was at academic conference and the vendor had a poster up and said they were going to be putting this functionality in their system. And I just looked at him and said, "You don't know anything about how that will affect students. And I don't think there's really very much research about whether this is a good idea or not, or for whom." And he said, "Yeah, you're right. So let's do some testing before, let's do it." And so if I hadn't challenged him, if I hadn't walked up and said, "What are you doing?" that collaboration wouldn't have happened.
So
Kevin, you have a question?
A question from one of those participating virtually. What questions or issues would lead one to add a data scientist to a project team?
Unmet need, okay, right? Just ask one of us.
Yeah.
we'll tell you if we can help or not.
Yeah. Okay, over here.
Hi, I'm Amber, and I work for the ITS department at University of Michigan. So my job is in database administration, and so I actually do a lot more with the getting of the data and the housing of the data and the delivering of the data, but...
Thank you. Yes. Thank you.
You're welcome. We work closely with ArcTS as well. But my question more relates to a couple of the presentations, Professor Teasley's and Cohn's talked about when you get the results at the end and you have that aha moment, or you have the results there showing you that something needs to change, and you spoke of risk and she spoke of resistance sort of, or what are your techniques for selling that, you know, to actually be implemented as something that changes in the future, or getting people over the defensiveness?
Well, I don't think we're over it yet. I think the university is a place where we really can't tell professors what to do. We can't tell them how to teach. And we certainly, there are other kinds of educational institutions that do have more authority over their instructors and how courses. That's not how we roll here at Michigan and many other places like this. So my hope is that by doing clear and coherent research and presenting them with data, they'll be open to what the results are pointing them to. I think nobody does this job if they really don't care about their students' learning. And sometimes we get a little bit too preoccupied with the research, but fundamentally we have to reach the students that we're teaching, and I think that we just appeal to that sense of, hey, I can help you do this better. There's a better way, or we can, you know, tweak it. Maybe we want to talk about tweak rather than overhaul, but I'm hopeful with data, that data helps.
So you see the data scientist role as having influence still in that area, like once you present the data, though, still having to influence how that's going to change things, but not necessarily pushing?
Yeah, I think it's an influencer. I'm not an expert in curriculum design, So I don't feel it's my job to tell instructors how to teach, but I can inform people who do and provide them with some sense of validity and direction, indicate where caution is necessary. And also, I think one of the really interesting things about the learning analytics work is it really helps reveal all the ways that we could pay more attention to personalizing the learning experience. And anybody who's sat in one of our large over 400 student courses knows there's very little that's personal about that. So how can we change that experience without requiring an instructor to treat every single student as, you know, as an individual? But that would be paralyzing as an instructor in the front of the room. Great. Thank you very much.
Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Anna, and I was really kind of curious if you guys have encountered a lot of, like, gender bias in the field, and if you have, like, how you've dealt with that.
Who's going first?
So yes and no. So my community sits at the overlap of electrical engineering and computer science, and it's definitely still predominantly male. There are moments, for example, in poster presentations when you go around with a male colleague and the person who's presenting doesn't make eye contact with you at all, which still drives me completely insane. I probably should work on that. But so I think the way I've tried to face that is by being present. And perhaps if someone is not paying attention, you make your voice heard and you make sure you continue to have a seat at the table and you don't retreat into your shell, but you continue to advocate for your beliefs. Because while things are changing, it's important to continue to push forward and advocate.
I'm from a similar field, but I'm from the more electrical engineering side, so I think the ratio is probably more tilted towards male dominance. So I think where I feel most affected, by and large, I go through my daily life, I work with my students and so on, I don't really necessarily feel it. The one place I feel it is, that it exists, is in actually going back to collaborative relationship. Now, how successful you are in building your network and establishing a collaborative network is very much, I think, a function of your personality, what you do, and so on. I am the more quiet kind. I'm not particularly proactive necessarily. I mean, I talk to people. So what I'm trying to say is I look at myself, this type of personality, and I look at an imaginary male colleague of a similar personality, then I think that male colleague's chance of getting collaborators is much higher than mine. I think there are a lot of evidence. That is not to say that I don't have female colleagues who are extremely successful in that area. So as I said, it is a function of personality and environment you're in and so on. But I think depending on where you are on that spectrum, you could be at a disadvantage.
So I have been one of Mignon's collaborators off and on. She's fantastic to work with. So I don't think I have experienced any sort of anything overtly. I can tell you that over many years, I'm in my mid-40s. Over many years, I have been the only woman in a math class, the only woman on the high school bus math team going to some competition. I often look around the room at my conferences and say, wow, I am the oldest woman in this room. I'm looking around today, I'm not the oldest, not the most senior woman in this room. So it's nice to be in a venue where we can hear all women who are fantastic researchers discussing what they are really excited about and all of their wonderful successes. And I encourage you to keep at the work that you're passionate about.
and yeah.
Just to add something in terms of myself, I'm not a particular person like very outspoken, and usually pretty soft, and so sometimes I feel like being outspoken, especially if there's a big discussion and or in a conference or places you have to voice your opinion, and sometimes when I feel like, especially in a room with a lot of my field, by the way, is signal processing and statistics, so it's there are some females, I think, maybe better than some other fields, but still pretty male dominant. So while you're surrounded by a room full of male professionals, sometimes you feel like, do I voice opinion now or do I wait? So sometimes you just never speak up. So I feel like sometimes it's your own courage and your own, how do you face yourself, and this kind of courage and spoken up and really represent yourself. And I think sometimes it comes from inside. But where does this inside thing come from? I think it's a very long-term influence from how you were brought up or maybe the way. And I should admit that, I think in the process of becoming a female professor, there's a lot of moments that I feel like, oh, I just don't want to do this anymore. This is too much. And I just want to be like what my parents or my family want me to do and just have kids, have a regular family without having to work so hard, so much traveling, and just be regular women. So there are some bias and, culture thing, pressure sometimes on you, but I think in the end, you just have to, motivate. Sometimes you just sit there and quiet and think it through and say, is this really the thing you want to do, you want to pursue? And once you have that courage, I think, yeah.
But I have to weigh in because anyone who knows me knows I'm not shy and I'm not reticent to speak up. And I feel like the older I get, the more likely I am to do that. So I have my soapbox that I carry around with me and I stand on it proudly and use it. When I can, because I feel like, because there are women who aren't comfortable with that. And also, you know what, I have less to lose. I totally acknowledge that my junior women colleagues, especially pre-tenure, do not necessarily feel empowered to stick their neck out. And that's just the way the system is. So, or if you're someone who's just like, that's just not your style, that's fine, but find support for whatever your style is, and make sure that you're not suffering alone, right? If you have complaints or you have concerns, or you just feel like you need to figure this out with someone, or say it out loud to someone to see how it sounds and what their reaction is, find that support network. What I don't want is, no matter how you what you personally feel is that you're driven out of the science because you don't feel you have a place in it. So if you're feeling that way and you're thinking this isn't for you, go find some women, mentors, who can help you figure that out and can, cheer you on in whatever way you need to follow your passion.
Thank you.
So let's do two more questions, because I know that the Stanford live stream will start in about 5 minutes. Yes, 5 minutes. And then we will enjoy lunch while the live stream is going. So let's see, two more questions. So one and then two.
My name is Laura. I'm a stats grad student here. And I'm interested in kind of the ethics of data science. And so my question for you is, what do you think about for your unintended biases that maybe you put in your conclusions of your data, and then also unexpected uses that become of it? So the two things that kind of came to mind for me listening to your talks was the FICO credit scores. I wasn't sure if that was for businesses specifically, but if you're a minority or a small business or a nonprofit, maybe you don't have quite those resources, or maybe you don't even know about it, so that could bias people in that sense, who are already kind of on a lower level than big companies. And then the other thought I had was for the language processing one, do you think about cultural differences for how speeches and how you perceive emotion? I would even think just having people from Minnesota versus New York would express their emotions much more differently. So I just want to know kind of how you approach that and how you think of these questions beforehand.
I had the exact same question, so I'm just going to head back about the cultural diversity.
Um, I'll go ahead. So it's very much a learning experience, an educational experience. When we first did this, because our label sets were so small, we couldn't afford to down select, essentially. It was, everything was in so now that it's in production, I'm seeing exactly that side of it. So I would say there are people who are very, very concerned about this type of bias. I was told, for instance, one of the most predictive feature of delinquency rate is income. Surprise, surprise. And yet that is one thing they do not use in the model. That doesn't mean that it's entirely kosher, because essentially
it's
a substitute for...
I'm Judy Logan. I'm co-director of this Women in Data Science conference, and this
Hi, I'm Karen Holland. Mathis, and it's great to see you all, and welcome to sunny California. but we're thrilled you're here today.
So before we start the live stream, we thought we'd get the housekeeping out of the way. We wanted to make sure that you know that we've got coffee in the back.
I don't think there's a systematic way, at least in the field that I work in, but I think people are conscientious about it, and it's an iterative process.
So actually, I was going to say, there are people interested, there are people in sort of theoretical computer science and algorithms who are working on what does it mean rigorously, precisely, to define fairness. And people who are working on what's called algorithmic fairness, they are also working in conjunction with social scientists, lawyers, et cetera. So yeah, there are people looking at principled ways of doing, you know, sort of fair machine learning.
So from our perspective, so when we're looking for a subtly expressed modulation of a signal, we usually, at the first step, like to control as many things as possible. And so right now that's cultural variability. I will say we have a grant in now that will expand both in terms of language and culture. It's a huge, I mean, first of all, it's important. Second of all, it's just a really interesting question about how emotions are expressed differently, how moods are expressed differently, how people either mask their symptoms or don't as a function of who they're talking to, as a function of their culture. So it's a really interesting societal question. It's a really interesting engineering question. The reason why we don't do it initially is just so that we have a better chance of finding the signal correlates, but then once we do, we look at expanding out. I do want to address another side of ethics and privacy also, which is that when you start to have huge amounts of data about people, I mean, we collect raw cell phone conversational data from our participants, and so I think it's completely critical, independent of what NIH says, independent of what the IRB says, that we impose an even more rigorous standard of privacy, because if participants are willing to give us the data that is so very personal, then I think it's our responsibility to try to treat it with the utmost respect and utmost care, and make sure at every stage, excuse me, we understand and they understand potential privacy implications. It's our responsibility as engineers and data scientists.
All right, that's great. So why don't we all give ourselves a round of applause for our speakers and our panelists. In data science, where their research is going, where is it going with because of data science, and to learn about new challenges that they may have. The secondary goal of this program is to spark